morning, everyone. Welcome to Word of Faith Family. This is Resurrection Sunday or Easter Sunday, whatever you want to call it. This is the day that we come to celebrate Jesus' sacrifice for us. We want you to celebrate with us. Thank you.
No matter where you're at this morning, I just want you to close your eyes right now. We're fixing to sing this song. It's called Majesty. It's a fantastic song. It's relevant for today. So Lord, right now in Jesus' name, we come to you. Lord, we just thank you for everything you've done. Lord, we thank you for protecting us, Father. We thank you for your Son who came, gave it all, and then rose again. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity that we could just stand right here, no matter if it's on this stage, if it's at home, in front of your TV, or on your phone, that we can stand right here in your presence. Lord, we can just close our eyes, we can feel you. And Father, right now, I just pray, Lord, for your Holy Spirit to just flow throughout all the devices. Lord, flow in this room, Father, in Jesus' name. Lord, I just pray that we'll listen to this song. Lord, we'll take these words to heart. And Lord, we'll just think about you more and more, and we'll fall farther and farther in love with you. Just listen to the words.
just as I am, empty handed but alive in your hands. We sing majesty. We sing majesty. Forever I am changed by your love. In the presence of your majesty.
Resurrection Sunday, the grave is empty today. Jesus Christ is risen, sits at the right hand of the Father, making intercession for you and I. Praise the Lord. Aren't you excited?
I am excited. Amen.
Amen. Didn't we have a good worship time just before? I praise God for our talent in our church and their ability to sing.
Thank
and
you,
to
Lord.
Worship
yes.
God. I'm just so thankful for our people,
yeah.
Aren't you?
Amen.
Yeah.
It's awesome.
Yeah, it is. And so we've got several things that's coming up this week. Don't forget our regular stuff that goes on every day. We have prayer at 7 o'clock. We have Ruby that comes on every day at 2 o'clock. We have a Wednesday night class with me. You need to check in. And also on Thursdays, we have Ashley.
Kids
it's
Corner.
Just, yeah, Kids Corner. Noon. It's 12 noon. Thank you, baby. And it's just going to be great. And so don't forget that we've also got the teens are going to start theirs this week, too, on Instagram. I tell you, we've got some good things
Amen.
Going.
Good
have
stuff.
We not?
Good
we
stuff
sure do.
Going. Today's a good day.
It is a good day.
And it's a good time to take up the offering.
Yes, it is.
And I just want to say thank you. You've been very mm-hmm. supportive. And your tithes and offerings, of course, they belong to God, and they're being used wisely.
Right.
And so don't forget us. And we're just going to say our blessing real quick
yes,
so
we
can get right on into our service
Amen.
This morning.
Yes.
So if you got your hand up, you got your tithes and offerings,
yes.
and even if you don't have it in your hand, you got it in your heart.
That's right.
So
here we go.
It's a day to celebrate, so now we get to celebrate giving.
Yes,
Amen.
Mm-hmm.
So, Lord, I choose to obey your word,
for
as I dwell and walk in your presence, I shall not lack.
Poverty
be far
from
me
and
my household,
in
Jesus'
name.
I will walk in your blessings, Lord. I will rise above all that hell has to offer and accept heaven's best here on earth. Everything I set my hands to will prosper because I make you my dwelling place. You are my refuge and my fortress. Thank you, Lord, for your provision. I accept it by faith, fully expecting your blessings in every area of my life. For wherever your presence is, there is no lack. Therefore, Lord, as we receive today's offering, we are believing you for abundant harvest, health, jobs and better jobs, raises and bonuses, benefits, sales and commissions, favorable settlements, estates and inheritance, interest and income, rebates and returns, checks in the mail, gifts and surprises, scholarships and grants, inventions with royalties, finding money, bills paid off, bills decreased, blessings and increase, bargains and child support. Thank you, Lord, for meeting all of our financial needs, that we may have more than enough to give into the kingdom of God and promote the gospel of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah and amen.
Hey, don't forget, today is Resurrection Sunday. We want to have your photos. Send us photos.
Yes.
We want your photos of you and your family watching the program today. Okay? I think that I'm done. Are you?
We're ready.
Let's get into the message.
Amen.
Good morning and welcome then to our fourth broadcast today. For most of you, it's Easter today, it's Resurrection Day. I'm reminded of what one scripture says, why look for the living among the dead. And if you find a grave today, it'll be empty. Jesus won't be there. I'm reminded, Susan, I think last week mentioned that today the churches would be empty, but so would the tomb. And I thought about that because a building without Jesus is just a grave anyway. But any building where Jesus lives, I'm telling you, it's a temple, and that's who we are, that's where we are, and that's what it's about today. It's early for me, and I've just spent a lot of time thinking about what I want to share on Easter Sunday. Normally it's a very, very busy day. It's a wonderful day. Sometimes it's the busiest day of the year for the church, and it's always a very exciting time. And we have no normals now, so this has become our new normal to stand in front of the cameras and to present to you. And I know that we're reaching a lot of people, and there are a lot of you out there that are friends, and there are a lot of you that are family members. And then there are some of you that maybe I've never met and you don't know me. So we've tried to incorporate a little bit. I like to share my history and my past some, and I know that a lot of you don't know me or where I've come from or what I'm all about. This week, I've worked a lot this week. I'm a bivocational pastor, and I work for MFA Incorporated, and we put in a lot of hours, and I spend a lot of time on the road sometimes. And I was driving through a country setting and thinking about Easter and the memories that come along with it. And I went past a house, and it almost brought tears to my eyes because it took me back to my roots and growing up and the memories that I have at home, family, siblings, mom and dad. Holidays like Easter, our cousins and family members would come in from all parts of the country. I came from a huge family. And we'd be going to either one of our two grandmas on that particular day. And there was just all the festivities. Now, I didn't always grow up in church, and so a lot of Sundays we weren't in church. But yet, it was a Christian home, it was a moral home, and we enjoyed the benefits of Christianity, even though we may have done it on a different scale than what some of you did. As I drove past this homestead that day, it reminded me so much of my childhood. There was the little country house and a small yard, and the barnyard and animals in it, and a garden spot and a few flowers. The grass was mowed. It looked so neat and so clean, and it just took me back. And I pray that during this time that your memories will take you back. We're establishing some new normals, it looks like. But one thing that we cannot change is our past and our history, and it has produced us today who we are, how we think, what we do, where we go. And so I'm sure that that's not all bad. There's a lot of that that's really good. And it won't be such an exciting time in the church world today. There won't be a lot of little girls with new dresses and little boys with new spring clothes. And I'm the kind of guy that I dress up every Sunday, though a lot of people don't anymore in the church. But when Easter Sunday came, everybody dressed up. It was a wonderful day. It was a day of celebration, and truly that's what we want to do, is celebrate Jesus. And so we observe Passover week. I pray that you realize that it's about halfway through now. And there's a lot that went on from the time that Jesus rode into Jerusalem on that donkey, and they throwed those palm limbs out. There's a lot there. Susan taught on that on Wednesday night, and I pray that you tuned in and listened to that. There is so much. In fact, it's an amazing thing to think about everything that Jesus did during those final days, as his final preparations for what his whole mission was about. And there, he had to complete a course. You'll be reminded, and I'll remind you of it, that when he hung on that cross at the very end, he said, "It is finished." Some of the most powerful words that he ever spoken in those three, because he had literally accomplished everything by his birth all the way through to his death, and that had to be accomplished before he could give his life for us. And so it was finished. It's a great thing. The worst thing about our Easter past, the past Easters, I'll get it out right, is the fact that it was more about family sometimes than it was about God. And so we want to repent today and say, Father, forgive us for having made festivities and celebrations more about us than we made it about you. Let me remind you as pastor that we always have to keep God first. And if we don't get God first, then nothing else really matters. Yeah, family is very important, and God's put that second right behind him. When he established family, made his parents, gave his children, grandchildren, it's an awesome life when we keep God first. And so during today, I pray that you'll be reminded that it was John 3:16. It was God who so loved the world that he gave us his only begotten son, that whosoever might believe in him should not die but have everlasting life. And we don't have to perish. We have a hope. We have a future. And it's all because of everything that Jesus did, everything that he accomplished, and especially the fact that he gave his life. Now in Hebrews 9:22, it says, without the shedding of blood, that there is no remission of sin. And if you're a Bible scholar, or if you're not, I'm sure that you're well aware that in the beginning, Adam and Eve first failed, sinned in the garden. And because they did that, God literally had to take a life to give life. He had to kill an animal to make clothes for Adam and Eve. And from that day, that's the way it's been, a life for a life. In the Old Testament, if you've ever read that, if you know anything about it, I'm telling you, it was a bloody Old Testament. That's all there was to it. It was about sacrificing over and over again, lambs and rams and birds. And I'm telling you, they had sin offerings and they had trespass offerings. And there is so much detail in that Old Testament. But it was always about the blood being presented on the altar for the atonement of their sins. It's about the blood being the atonement for our sins. That's why the perfect sacrifice had to come in the form of Jesus Christ. Now, the Bible says that God looked throughout heaven and looked throughout earth, and there was absolutely no one who was worthy to come, no one that was capable or able. So he had to send his son Jesus Christ to this earth in order for mankind to be spared. And we're grateful today. I can't begin to tell you how thankful that I am in just the fact that I know what God did for us. When you have people in your life that you love, and even yourself, then you pretty much figure out how hard it is to lay your life down for someone, even for someone that you love. But for Jesus to come and lay down his life for the sins of the world, not just for good people, but for all people, regardless of race, skin, color, size, aptitude, none of those things figured in. He died for mankind. And so when he declared on the cross that it is finished, that meant that the price had been paid for every single one of us, so that our sins would not be accountable to us anymore. Our sin was laid on him. It's an amazing thing. And there's no way that I can preach everything that I might wanted to preach today. But the truth is, what we do in the church is we preach Jesus every day. We preach Jesus every week in one way or another. And so when this Sunday gets here, Resurrection Sunday, literally it's just about us celebrating together, rejoicing together, being so appreciative and saying, thank you, God, for what your son has done for us. Thank you for what you allowed him to do for us, because it was you who allowed him to go to that cross. And Jesus even said that if he had felt the need, if he had wanted to, if he had given up, that he could have called thousands of angels, 10,000s of angels to come and rescued him off of that cross. But he carried our load. He carried that. In Isaiah chapter 53, I encourage you to read that again this week, maybe even today. But look at how Isaiah prophesied in advance of the abuse that he was going to take. I'm sure that many of you have watched the movie that Mel Gibson made. And I'm telling you, that movie's worthy to be watched at least once a year for the rest of our lives. And I'm sure that I'm going to tune in and play that again. And I'm telling you, it gives probably the best actual description of everything that he went through, of anything that we can imagine. And I'm telling you, it was a tough deal, there's no doubt. So from the very beginning, from the Passover lamb, I'm sure that some of you are familiar with the term Passover, and that's what we're celebrating. It was one of the great feasts in the Old Testament. It's about when the children of Israel were held captive in Egypt after Joseph had traveled down through there in order to save God's people. And over the 400 years that they spent there, of course, the pharaohs changed and they began to become abused and became slaves. And at one point in time, the cries of God's children reached heaven, and God sent Moses down with Aaron, his brother, to lead God's people out. And after the 10 plagues, and there's been a lot of good movies made about the plagues, and Charlton Heston made a tremendous movie years ago. If you're an old-timer like me, you've probably seen it a couple times. And so it was good to know that God was still concerned about his people. And then again, we realized that the same way that deliverance came to us today came to them there. It was the shedding of blood, because the firstborn, the 10th plague, was the death of the firstborn. And so Moses instructed the people to go out and find the lamb, to find a perfect lamb without spot or blemish, to examine it for a period of time to make sure that it was a worthy lamb. And after, on that particular day, they were to slay that lamb and take that blood, and they posted it over the lintels on their doorposts. So when God allowed the death angel to pass over the land that night, that every house that had the blood over the lintels on the door, then they escaped the 10th plague. They escaped the death of the firstborn. And by just reading God's word and recorded history, we know that there were thousands and thousands of people that died, Egypt's firstborn, that night, and Pharaoh released God's people. And so that became the beginning of the Passover. It's still celebrated. And we have done that here a few times. It won't be possible for us to do that here, to have the Passover feast. It's called a Seder. Those Hebrew words can be pretty tough for a country boy like me. But it's very interesting, and it's noteworthy to know how that God delivers his people any way that he can, but it's always by the blood, because the atonement is in the blood. And then, of course, we have Jesus Christ, the perfect Passover lamb, who was tempted in all points like we are as man, who had no guile, had no sin, was angry without sin. I think we're all going to mess up there a few times in our life. So today is all about Jesus. That's all there is to it. And thank you, Lord, for loving us, for supplying for us salvation, for the new covenant. It's amazing. The new covenant is just such a tremendous thing. The promises of God that are so many, and yes, they are yes and they are amen. And when we begin to enter in to this new covenant, it kind of just brings us all the way back to where our theme is for the month. And our theme really for today is more about celebration, because it is a day to celebrate. And one of the ways that we can celebrate is through sacrifice. I know that I hope that you listened to last week's sermon. I was trying to set up our month, and I talked about how that to sacrifice means that we are to surrender, we are to give up, to turn loose, and literally to put others in front of us. And when you think about the life of Jesus Christ, what we're seeing is a life of sacrifice. From the beginning, he gave up heaven. He gave up his Father there, his place beside the throne, the beauty and the splendor of heaven. He said, I'm willing to give it all up, God. I'll go, send me. So he went. He came as a virgin birth. Look at the humility that's there. He came in obedience. He came in humility. And what we're going to learn the next couple weeks is how that obedience and humility leads us to sacrifice. And so we have the perfect example, because Jesus, Bible says, learned obedience through the things which he suffered. And so no doubt from the time that he was a little boy that he suffered many things of many people all through his life. I'm sure that he took every kind of abuse there ever was. He took it as a child of God, but as a child of man. When he became a man, and we read in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the four Gospels, we read about all the abuse that he took. We read about how that men treated him bad. They lied on him. They accused him. He's still being accused. He's still being talked bad, but he's still Jesus. He held true to form through that whole time, through all the abuse. And when he says that the righteous shall suffer persecution, he knew what he was talking about, because he was the righteous Son of God who was persecuted in one way or another, physically, mentally, spiritually, in all ways was he abused. His whole life, though, was about, remember those three things, obedience, humility, and sacrifice. Now, let me share just real quickly this morning a couple thoughts that I had that God shared with me this week. One of them is what his sacrifice has brought to us. Now, when you take your Bible, it's divided into the Old Testament and the New Testament. And the Old Testament was the Old Covenant. That was the agreement that God made with man. And in an agreement, if one party does its responsibilities, then the other party will do theirs. The New Testament is the New Covenant. And it is God saying, here's what I will do for you if. Now, if is the biggest small word in the world. And the Bible is all about if. If you obey me, if you keep my commandments, God says, if you'll trust me, if you'll walk by faith, it's all about if, because he put the honoring of the New Testament covenant on my back and on your back. It's all about me doing what is right, and it's about you doing what is right. It's about me and you doing what God has told us to do, what God leads us to do. It's about you and I being obedient. And when we're obedient, then it will produce humility within us, and out of humility will come sacrifice on our part. Now, Jesus' sacrifice, and these are all explained in the Bible, and if I had a lot of time, if I was teaching this in a class, I would give you a lot of scripture, and that's why that when this is all over, it's really important if you want to learn to come visit us at Word of Faith Family, because we're all about teaching God's Word, and we're about sharing the good news, and we're about sharing one of the things that He brought, and that's hope. We have a new hope. We can hope for a better today, and then we can hope for a better tomorrow. We can hope that all things will get well, because all we have to do is read God's Word and find out that He's a God who's famous for doing good things in people's life. In fact, James said that He is the giver of good gifts, the Father of lights, in whom there is no variableness, neither shadow of turning, and that everything good comes from God. And so we have a new hope, and it's a hope about good things. It's a hope about a good day, a good life, about good health, about good finances. And we love that word because we like things that are good. Nobody goes to town and tries to buy something that's bad. We don't go into a car lot and say, hey, I want the worst car that you got on the lot. I want a bad one. I don't want a good one. We don't go into a restaurant and say, if you have a bad steak, I want the bad steak. No, we are a people who likes things good. In fact, if we knew anything about perfect, we would want things to be perfect. So we're not perfect people, so we settle for good. And we have a new hope that is a good hope. Not only that, but it's bound up in this new covenant. We can read the Old Testament, and the Old Testament proves the New Testament, even as the New Testament proves the Old Testament. We have the type and shadows of each one, and by the mouth of two or three witnesses, everything is established. And so when we're reading in the Old Testament, we can thank God and rejoice that we don't have to have a pen out back that's got some goats in it or some sheep in it or a ram in it. We don't have to have a bird cage so that we're going to keep the old covenant. We also, in this new covenant, the sacrifice has been made. Thank you, Jesus. Okay? And therefore, we don't have to go to a priest because we have the priest. We have the high priest, Jesus Christ. And so anywhere, at any time, under our new covenant, we can go and we can talk to God. We can pray in Jesus' name, and we know that God hears our petition. In fact, He knows everything that's going through our mind anyway. So we just well share with Him everything that we need to share. Now, in this new covenant, we have the new promises. And I'm telling you, the promises of God, like I said a while ago, they're yes and amen. When you read one, when you hear it, when I tell you that it's by Jesus' stripes we're healed, or when I read you 3 John verse 2, beloved, above all things, I want you to prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospers. Listen, those are some of God's promises to us. That means they're to me. That means I can look at my life, I can look at my wife and my children, my home, our family, our church, our building, our property, and I can look and I know that God's made me some very specific promises that He'll take care of us, that He'll provide all of our needs. And so instead of getting bound up in worry, we can cast all our care on the Lord. We could remember that the perfect sacrifice of Jesus Christ enabled us and enables us to achieve or to attain the promises of God, the new promises. In the Old Testament, they didn't have those promises. They lived, I'm telling you, it was a works religion. We don't have a works religion now. We have a faith religion. We have being a doer of the Word, not a hearer only, because when we do the Word works for us, and the promises of God become ours. We also have new blessings. We're blessed in ways that we don't even understand. I can go to work, and I can put in 48 hours in 3 days, and over the years, I've had a lot of different ones ask me, Brother Dale, when do you have time to prepare? When do you have time to get a sermon up? When do you have time? And I said, all I got to do, regardless of where I am, is have my ears tuned in to God. And if I tune in to Him, and I'm listening, and I'm watching, then God will reveal to me what God wants me to share. And literally, in 27 years, God has made preaching easy. I had an old friend He's gone into heaven now. Willie Earl Veith was our deacon for 19 years, and one time he asked me after I'd started pastoring, he said, Brother Dale, how do you like pastoring? And I said, hey, the preaching, that's easy, because God just gives you a sermon, and you present it the way that God gives it to you. I said, now the pastoring's a little bit different, because now you got to deal with other people. And even though I'm a people person and I love people, it still makes it a little bit difficult sometimes. But I love that. I love being good. I love helping people be good. I love to preach God's word. And I love to teach God's word and to expose the promises of God that produce literally the blessings of God. When you begin to receive His promises, you claim them for your own. I preached a sermon one time, and I liken the promises of God to gold mining, because you have to work at digging out your promise in the Word, but when you find it, you find the most valuable things that there are in the world. And literally, God's Word, the Bible, is a gold mine to me and to you, and it's up to us individually to dig out our promises out of this new covenant so that we find our blessings that go with that. And then, of course, we have the new life. And there's nothing like the new life. And let me just say to you today, if you haven't accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you just don't know what you're missing. Because it is the very best life ever. Even when things are not normal like they are now, even when we're part of a world system that's all messed up, I'm telling you, we have an anchor that holds. He's a solid rock. And the new life that He gives us is not just a good life, it's the best life that there can be. And God can take anything that's bad and make it good. God will turn a situation just like this situation. I'm standing here in my pulpit, and I'm preaching to you, and I'm looking out over our building. And as I look here today, I can look here, and there's Darren and Tammy. I see them in my heart. I see them in my mind. And there's my wife, there's my kids, there's my grandkids, and there's my sisters, and there's my brothers. And I know where most of you sit. So yeah, Connie, I see you there. And I see you, Janet, back there, way back in the back. And Tony snuck in late. And over here on this side, there's Lisa. And if she's not the last one here, Debbie is. Now, there's Debbie. So Debbie wasn't the last one today. And Ruby's here. And see, it's just all part of something that's new and different. But you know what? God's still here, even though me and the guys are here and we're videoing this, because we're living a kind of life that God makes new every day, and we're still reaping the blessings from the promises that we have dug out from the covenant because we have the new hope. And there are a lot of other good things that I could share with you today that I won't, simply because time's sake for the most part. But I'm telling you that God loves us, and God has done a lot of things. And He done them through Jesus Christ, His Son. Now, there is a teaching, and I'm not going to go into detail now, but, you know, we don't sometimes stop and explore everything that Jesus did. And He became the perfect sacrifice, and in becoming that perfect sacrifice, it's amazing how that you can explore His life, do it in detail, and that's why that you just can't preach everything about Jesus in one sermon. You have to do it 52 weeks out of the year. But the Bible says that He bled 7 different ways. And for Bible scholars, you know that's very significant, because the number 7, one of the most powerful and one of the most commonplace numbers that there is throughout God's Word. We call it God's number. It means to be finished, to be complete. And it's about God's number that came to pass through the life of Jesus by the way that He bled. Now, if you'll remember that the blood is for the atonement of our sin. And without the shedding of that blood, there's no remission of sin. And I like the word removal, because not only was there a remission, did it ease off, but it was removed. The Bible says in the book of Psalms that as far as the east is from the west, in a sea of forgetfulness, it's not going to be remembered again. God forgets it. I'm telling you, when God does something, it's done. But it was very significant that Jesus bled 7 different ways. He bled the first time in the garden that evening when He went to pray. And He took 3 of His favorite disciples, and He asked them to pray for an hour, and He come back and they were sleeping. You can read that in John 19, I believe that it is. And it says that Jesus prayed so hard, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. But it was not possible. But he bled. The Bible said that his sweat became as drops of blood because his prayers were so intense. He was praying so hard. He was under such an attack at that moment that I know that the enemy was trying to get him to turn away. And I'm telling you, the devil didn't think that Jesus could make it all the way through, but Jesus made it. He done it. We know that. We also know that he was bruised. And Isaiah 53 said that he was bruised for our iniquities. And now a bruise is an internal bleeding. We all have sin in our life. We have iniquity. There's things that are there. It's why that we spend a lifetime studying God's word and trusting him so that God can clean up our lives. And so you may be listening today and you think, oh, I'm not worthy of being a Christian. I don't know if that's me or not. Let me tell you, we've all had our shortcomings. We've all failed. But Jesus bled. He shed his blood so that no matter what our iniquity was, no matter what we'd been through in our life, no matter what we were going to face, that when that point came in our life, Jesus had already been there and he already gave his life for us in that instance with his blood. We do know that he was tied to a whipping post and beat with 39 stripes. And the Bible says, it says it in the Old Testament and also in the New Testament, it's by his stripes that we are healed. We preach healing here. We use that scripture. By his stripes, we are healed. And there's some significance in the 39 stripes that we won't get into. I challenge you as a pastor to do a little research and study on that one sometime. We also know that they plaited a crown of thorns and put on his head. And so he bled from his brow. And it had to do with the mindsets that we have. It had to do with breaking the curse of lack and poverty that was over God's people and is still over so many of God's people, because the curse of lack and poverty is a mindset that has to be broken. And so Jesus bled from that point so that our mindsets could be changed. His hands were pierced with nails. His feet were pierced with other nails or with spikes. And what he was doing was giving the dominion back to mankind. In the Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve lost it when sin came. But by Jesus' atonement through his blood, he gave dominion back to mankind. We are to have authority. In fact, we are to put the enemy, literally, the Bible says, under our feet. Remember that. And there's nothing that two hands can accomplish when they're given to God. And there's nowhere that two feet can't go and accomplish what God wants to accomplish, simply because in the sacrifice of Jesus, he bled from his hands and he bled also from his feet. And then, of course, we know that at the end, after he had already died, that they thrust the spear into his side and it came out as water and blood. And that's because literally he died from a broken heart. And so we know in Luke 4 that one of the ministries, Jesus said, I'm anointed to bind up the brokenhearted. And he has the ability to do that. You may be watching today. And in fact, with this whole mess that we're part of, I'm sure that there are a lot of hearts that they may not be broken, but some of you may be torn a little bit. We long to see family. We long to have family dinners. We long to be in church. We're longing to be with other people. We want life to get back to a normal, one of which we're accustomed to. And so I'm sure today that there are a lot of heavy hearts, but right now at this moment, I pray that your heavy heart will be lightened up and that you'll celebrate today as Resurrection Day, knowing what Jesus did and knowing that he bled seven different ways so that we would not have to experience the things that we experience in life. And when we recognize what he has paid for us and we begin to accept his sacrifice on our life and adapt his policies as our policies to live his life, to live our lives the way that he lived his life, to allow him to be our leader, our savior, our guide, our comforter, everything that he wants to be in our life, then our lives change. And it goes back to what we shared a while ago. We can live the new life that God has promised for us. Now today, I want to close, and I need to get out of here myself, but I'm telling you that we miss you and that we love you. And if my family was here, if my wife was here, the rest of my kids and stuff, we would say to you today as a family that we really love you. We love your support. We love your prayers. We love the fact that you're watching us on YouTube and on Facebook. We love you tuning in, Sister Ruby. We love you tuning in to the prayer time in the morning. We love you tuning in to the Kids Corner, to the teen program, and to anything that we put out there. We thank you. We love you. And we appreciate your thoughtfulness And today, we want you to just have a great day. We want you to have a wonderful resurrection day. If you've never met us and you're just watching us out of curiosity, we say have a great day, have a blessed day. Trust God, live for God. If you don't know Him, remember the Roman road and just take yourself to your knees and accept Jesus Christ as your Savior. For my church family, for those of you that I know are watching, we love you. And yeah, we miss you. Thank you for the drive-by. And we're working on doing a few different things, church family. Maybe a parking lot service for long when the weather gets good. Who knows? You just keep praying. We'll just keep doing our best part. And so for now, I'm just going to say happy Easter, happy Passover, happy Resurrection Day. Celebrate Jesus. Enjoy life. Enjoy the good things today. Just do the best that you can and trust God. And remember, we are to walk by faith and not by sight. And before I let you go, we're going to do our blessings today. And so listen up. Deuteronomy chapter 20, verse 3 and 4, and Numbers 6, 24 through 26 says this: Hear, my children, as you approach each day your battles, don't let your hearts faint. Fear not, do not tremble, neither be afraid, for the Lord our God is He that goes with us to fight for us against all of our enemies, to keep us safe. And now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord makes His face to shine upon you and is gracious to you. The Lord lifts up His countenance upon you and gives you His peace. Hallelujah and amen. God bless you, and we love you.